So what does Christmas mean anyway? Love. What does Christmas mean? It means more of Jesus. Amen? More of God, more of the Messiah. And so we're going to celebrate. Amen? And you're happy today, right? I mean, if there's any time of the year that you should be happy, this is it. Amen? So take the frown off your face, put a smile on, sit back and relax. Enjoy Jesus, enjoy what God is doing. And remember, this week we have Christmas Eve services coming up. And it's at 5 and 7. Adeline Cruz will be with us. We have some very special stuff to present. The Christmas story, nativity scene, candlelight service. Amen. Invite your friends. Now, you were doing okay till right then. Come on. Invite your friends. Listen, this is the easiest time of year to invite someone to come to church, especially on Christmas Eve. Lots of people love to go to church on Christmas Eve. And who knows what God might do? It might be a Christmas miracle. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So I want you to think this morning before we worship together. The choir got us started. We're going to celebrate. They're all smiling. I don't see any of them that look unhappy this morning. And that's good. But before we worship together, I want you to watch this video, because often there's something missing at Christmas time. And we go through a lot of motions and formality, but we don't realize what's missing. So watch this video, and right after the video, then we're going to worship together. And everybody said?
Amen.
Okay, here we go.
Hey, Ed, come check out my North Star Christmas tree topper. It levitates.
Is this a gummy bear?
Yeah, we lost baby Jesus. Hey, check out these LED lights. I have them synced up to a 76-hour all Christmas music playlist.
There's my little Christmas DJ.
Ow.
So, are you waiting till Christmas is over so you can go buy a new nativity set when they're on sale?
Huh? No. We lost baby Jesus like 11 years ago.
Is baby Jesus always a gummy bear?
No. We trade it out every year. Yeah, like last year it was a tiny troll doll. And the year before that we used a dog treat. They were the perfect size, but Dalton kept taking them and eating them.
You mean your dog kept stealing them?
No, my son Dalton. He loves those dog treats. Especially the peanut butter ones. There was one year that we used a doll head. That was creepy. We made a modeling clay baby Jesus. So the dog took that one too. One year we got desperate and used an ice cube. That was a miss and a mess. Yeah, just seems like everything we try to replace baby Jesus with never lasts.
Say that again.
Everything we try to replace baby Jesus with never seems to last.
And
what?
Say it again, slowly.
Why?
Just do it, dulcimo, slowly, do it.
I don't understand what's happening.
Just do it.
This is getting weird.
Dang it!
Fine! But when I'm done saying this, you're gonna march in here, and you're gonna watch my star levitate.
I'm fine, do it.
Fine. Everything we try to replace baby Jesus with never seems to... Oh, yep, there it is. Okay. Merry Christmas.
Stand with us this morning as we worship together.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant.
Oh,
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all anew?
We do.
And is all creation groaning?
It
is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
And is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seals and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this?
He is.
He dwells among us.
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And is Jesus our Messiah, hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Our God intent to dwell again with us.
He does.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David his root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he is David's to me. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of it?
Unto us is born this day in the city of David, Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Aren't you glad? Whew. I can breathe now. Sing it with me.
Oh,
else do we see? Above thy deep and dreamless sea, the silent stars arise. Yet in thy dark street shine the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the are met in thee tonight. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above. While mortals sleep, the angels keep their morning stars to gather, proclaim this holy birth, and praises sing to God our King, and peace to men on earth. O holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings. Oh, come to us, abide in us, our Lord Emmanuel.
Would you join me this morning in prayer? God with us, what a gift. Thank you for coming down and giving us hope. Because we would not have it within ourselves, but because you became what we needed to have and be, we now can stand here and say, oh, come, all ye faithful, let us adore him. So today, Father, we thank you for your gift to us. And now we give back to you that which you've blessed us with. We give it freely with great hearts of joy to say thank you for our blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. God bless you.
Silent night like
So this morning, Christmas Sunday, I want you to just think for a moment about who came. Oh, of course, we know Jesus came. But who came? Who was in Bethlehem? There were shepherds. They heard an announcement, remember? Angels and a multitude of heavenly hosts. And they said, oh, let's go. And they didn't have a committee meeting or anything else. They just said, let's go and see this thing which the Lord has done. And they made haste. They came. They were seeking. What did they find? That's the question. And this morning, it wasn't just wise men or shepherds. There were others. Did you ever think about the unknown? Who came? Who was there? I mean, God certainly couldn't tell us everyone that was there. We couldn't carry the book around to read it. But I want to read from Matthew chapter 2, and then we're going to watch just a short video clip, and I'll come back. But we don't pay as much attention to Matthew 2 as we do Luke 2. We do know the story. When Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, verse 1, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. Not to Bethlehem, Jerusalem. Saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him. When Herod the king heard these things, he was troubled, and Jerusalem with him. They had a king. And when he had gathered all of the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. Now remember, this is the inspired word of God. And so I find it really interesting that that word demanded is there. And I think God was really intentional, because Herod was unhappy. And they said unto him in Bethlehem, I think they might have been a little surprised that they knew more about what was happening than the king did. In Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, art not the last among the princes of Judea, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And when he sent them to Bethlehem, he said, go and search diligently for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come to worship him. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented to him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed unto their own country another way. They were seeking. They found. What will you find? What will you find at Christmas? Watch this video.
What child is this? Yes, yes, that is the question. That has always been the question. What child is this? That single question was the driving force behind our lengthy journey. We had to figure out what child this is. And I know. My friends, we have been called wise by many of the people we encountered along our journey, if even for a brief moment. I hesitate to give much credence to their judgment. But it is known, or it should be known, that knowledge is acquired by keeping one's eyes open and mouth shut. So, may I suggest that you keep your mouths closed and your ears open, and I will, to the best of my ability, answer your question as clear as I can. One, we did not stumble upon this child. No, we found a needle in a haystack. And how did we find this needle? We followed the star. I know. To many, that would be considered a fool's errand, but we are no fools. No, that star was moved by some unseen force. And who moves stars but God? Two, we encountered that corrupt king. That king wanted us to find the child so that he could worship the child. My friends, do kings worship babies? No. Kings defend their thrones. And that king, that Herod, is a ruthless and cruel despot. It does not take a wise man to discern that. And that king felt that this child was a threat. And mark my words,
is a threat to all who are cruel and ruthless. And three, I don't have words for three. My entire life I have searched, and yet it was always just beyond the horizon of my knowing. Until, in an instant, I crossed a threshold, and there it was. That father, that mother, that star, the child. It was all there. All my searching, all my studying. It was all right there. All in that child. How could I not worship him? I need search no more.
So once you find Jesus, the search is over. Because he's all we need, amen? So what are you searching for? I mean, we spend most of our lives searching, if we're honest with ourselves. And especially at the Christmas season, we're searching, right? We search for perfect gifts. We search for bargains. We search for the right debt. You know, I like this one service thing, by the way. Feels really good. We search for the bargain. We search for the right decoration. Sometimes we search for the right parking spot. Yeah. And do any of those things even matter? In the end, they really don't. Many people that very first Christmas didn't discover what the wise man discovered. Why? Because they were too busy. They were searching. They were looking for other things. I would suggest the politicians missed the first Christmas, just like the politicians are missing this Christmas too. It's okay, you can say amen. The business community probably missed it because they were busy. They had things to do and places to go and people to see. The innkeeper, oh, poor guy, we beat up on him. We talked about it. He probably missed it. We don't know. He's just there and then we never hear about him again. The religious establishment missed it. They were looking for other things. Who enjoyed that first Christmas a little more than 2,000 years ago? Who was it? They were people who were looking for it. They were people who were looking for truth. They were people that were paying attention to God when he spoke. The angels told the shepherds, you will find the baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and what? Yeah, see, you know the story, don't you? And the shepherd said, let's go see. They found Jesus. Why? They were searching for him. They were seeking. And what does God say to us? Seek and you will. Of course. The wise men found Jesus. Why? They were taking a journey. And they weren't just wandering around in the wilderness trying to figure out where they would go next. It's true, they probably didn't have a map, but they had a star. And they were following the star. They found Jesus because they were seeking. They arrived in Jerusalem and they said, "We have come from the east and we've come to worship him." Wow. That must have shocked Herod. Worship? What is that? Worship? Worship a baby? You got to be kidding. What are you going to find at Christmas? It's a great question, isn't it? You'll find whatever you're looking for. It's true. You'll find whatever you're paying attention to, because actually whatever has your attention, it's got you. It has you. Oh, how do I know that? Scripture says, as a man thinks in his heart, what? So is he. Wow. Yeah, you're going to find whatever you're looking for. Whatever's on your mind, you'll end up finding it. And so we spend a lot of our life just asking this simple question, is there any meaning to life? And when we're asking that question, we're actually seeking something, amen? Meaning, hope, significance. Sometimes we ask, is there a God? Or we ask God, where are you? And if there is a God, how could we ever possibly get to know him? That's what Christmas is about. It's about knowing God, because God wants to know us. It's about God making the first step. He made the first move while we were still sinners. The scripture says Christ died for us, right? So we didn't have to do anything to get God to love us. He loved us already. Wow, that's really good news, and that's what Christmas is about. God coming down, God showing his love to us. So you don't have an outline this morning because you really don't need one. I'm going to give you 3 points, and then I'm going to actually read a story to you at the end. What are the 3 points? Well, if you're seeking, you could find forgiveness. That's the first one. You can find forgiveness. This year I've been putting one verse on everything that I do. Luke chapter 2, verse 11. Today a Savior is born. Unto you this day a Savior, I'm doing King James now, is born. He is Christ the Lord. And I've talked about that. That's personal to you. I've talked about that. It's a present experience, not just 2,000 years ago, but right now, because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And just as he came to them 2,000 years ago, although he came in a physical body, today he comes to us in his spirit, just as real. Precious, a Savior. We needed that. But you can't ever receive a Savior until you know you need one. And that's part of what Christmas is about. So we can find forgiveness. Jesus didn't come to lord it over us, although he is Lord. He didn't come to beat us down. He came to lift us up. He came to save us. Jesus, Savior of sinners. That's what his name means. I'm not going to go into all the reasons why we need a Savior, but every one of us in this room this morning, if we're the least bit reasonable, know that none of us are perfect. Amen? We need somebody to save us from ourselves. But not only that, heaven is a perfect place, and since we're not perfect, we can't get in unless somebody does something for us. That somebody is Jesus. He was perfect. He paid the price to give us a second chance, to wash us clean from our sin through his shed blood. Sometimes we don't realize how much we need a Savior. And sometimes we do, but we don't like plan A and we hope God has a plan B. But God doesn't have any plan B. It's only plan A, Jesus. Sometimes we're like the little boy that wrote a letter to Santa Claus. Dear Santa, there are three boys living at my house. Jeffrey is 2, David is 4, Norman is 7. Jeffrey is good some of the time. David is good some of the time. Norman is good all of the time. I am Norman. Problem is, none of us are Normans. None of us are always perfect. Sometimes we live with a sense of regret because we know we're not perfect. We know that we hurt people, or we know that we hurt ourselves, or we know that we hurt God. That's why we need a Savior. How do we let Christ save us? Simple. All who believe in Jesus' name will be forgiven of their sins through his name, Acts 10:43. Simple. Let him do it. Simple, receive it. Trust him. Maybe even not being uptight, relax and just let God do the work. And we say, thank you. How do you get God to save you? Just admit you need him. That's it. It's that simple. We need a Savior. He's been provided. His name is Jesus. We need to accept that. We'll find that that is true if we're seeking for a Savior. God isn't trying to give us something that'll hurt us. He's trying to give us someone who will help us. And we need to accept his forgiveness. What else could we find at Christmas? We could find, oh, this is a good one, peace of mind. I mean, I know lots of people who say, man, I just need some peace. I also know lots of people who say, oh, this is so stressful. And you just watch them, and it's like they're just stretched this tight, and they're going to break any second if you touch them. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Peace is a word that the world uses a lot, but the reality is the world doesn't have the foggiest idea what the meaning of real, true peace is. Peace of mind. For some, it means self-medicating through whatever method. It might be TV, or it might be some kind of drug, or it might be alcohol, or who knows? For some, it means just staying busy so you don't have to think. Some, it means being a workaholic, or for others, peace means being an overachiever, but really, peace is none of those things. So much more. Three things will rob you of peace. You might want to just make a note about this because we all deal with these. What are they? Guilt, grief, grudges. Oh, preachers do that. They like alliteration. Our brains just think that way. Sometimes I'm just sitting having a conversation and the three M's come up, or the three D's come up, or whatever it is. Sometimes I even wonder, where did that come from? But these are real words. Guilt, grief, grudges. Those are three great destroyers of peace in our lives. So I want you to think about this. Guilt, you don't have to walk out of here with guilt. God is really clear. He says, I sent a Savior to wipe away your sins so you can be forgiven. And that means you have a clear conscience. No more guilt. I am free. You'll find that if you're seeking it. Grief. The truth be known, there are people in this room that are in major pain right this moment. I think about the loss of a loved one. It's hard to actually even fathom that my father's been gone 14 years, that my mother's been gone 21 years. It just seems like yesterday. And you know, we all think we're over it, but there is that moment when that grief just rolls around again. I don't even like to confess this, but I will. I can remember saying to my mother, when one of those moments of grief rolled around and it had been 30 years since her father was gone, and I said, "Why are you still crying?" Today, that's like, I feel like it stabs my own heart. I can't imagine I could have said it, except I didn't understand. Huh. Grief. Sometimes it's not over the loss of a loved one. Sometimes we have grief over a parent that abandoned us, or a divorce that we went through, or we have other things that have hurt us deeply and we grieve about it. And I want to say to all of us this morning that God cares about our hurts. He sees them. He knows what you've been through. And the truth is, you were never meant to carry that grief on your own. And that's why God sent Jesus, so that you could cast all your cares on him. He invites you to do that, and then he will care for you. If you'll do that today, cast your cares on him, you'll receive the gift of peace. Grudges. What is that? Grudges. Of course, no one in here has ever held a grudge. Amen? Because we're those perfect people, right? We go to church. Yeah. What is a grudge? It's being resentful. We feel guilty when we hurt others. We feel resentful when others hurt us. I want you to listen. You will be hurt in life. That's a fact. Did you get it? You will be hurt in life. It's not a matter of if. It's just a matter of when it's going to happen. And so how you respond to that hurt will determine your level of happiness as you go through life. And so for your own sake and for your own hope and for your own peace of mind, you have to let go of the hurt. And everybody said, resentment doesn't hurt them. It only hurts you. Wow. So you have to let go of it. You have to trust God. You can find peace of mind if you're willing to do the things that Christ says to do. So at Christmas, you can find peace. I think shepherds and wise men found forgiveness and restoration, and they found peace. What's the other thing you can find at Christmas? I'm actually going to give you a fourth one, but I'm not going to talk about it much. You can find eternal life. That's number three. Eternal life. I mean, who doesn't want to live forever? Come on. Now, some of us don't want to live forever in this body, because I don't know about you, but I'm getting to the place where my body's talking back to me. My brain says I can, but my body says, oh, no, you can't. So I'd be happy to trade in for a new version. And God says, listen, God says, I'm going to get that. Wow. I won't have any more pain. No more sorrow, no more suffering. Wow, that's going to be a day. That's why the songwriter wrote that song. What a day that will be when my Jesus I will see. Oh, wow. It's going to be a day. But the truth is, unless Jesus comes, this body is going to die one day. That's the truth. It's not a pleasant thought, but neither is it morbid. It's honest. And we need to be ready. We need to be prepared. We need to know where we're going, because the other truth is that just because the body gives up doesn't mean that we do. Our spirit lives forever. And we're going to spend more of our life on the other side of death than we do on this side. I mean, 60, 70, 80 years, that's nothing. It's going to be forever and ever and ever and ever, and it's never going to end. And I don't know about you, but I want to be in the right place. I want to be with Jesus. Now, only a fool would go through life totally unprepared for something that they know is inevitable. Only a fool would do that. And the truth is, you're not ready to die until you know Jesus. And the other truth is, you're not ready to live until you're ready to die. And you're not ready to do that until you know Jesus. And so that's why God sent his son, Jesus, so that we could have eternal life. But sometimes the problem is we don't really know what we're looking for in life. We think we're looking for happiness, and we try all kinds of ways to be happy. Isn't it true? We try spending money. That doesn't work. We try getting money. That doesn't work. We try going on trips. That doesn't. All of those things are temporary. They may give you a thrill for the moment, and then you got to have it again, or you don't feel okay. Sometimes we think that we're looking for love. Trouble is, we look for love in all the wrong places. I think there have been a few songs that have been written about that, don't you? But Jesus is love, perfect love. Sometimes we try success, or we try just making sure we have security, or we just want to be important. We're looking for meaning and purpose in life. We're looking for all of these things, but actually what we're looking for is none of those things. We're looking for God. So who had peace, and who had forgiveness, and who realized the path to eternal life? It was shepherds. It was the shepherds. It was wise men. It was Mary. It was Joseph. It was Elizabeth. Wow. So the good news at Christmas is, all the time that we've been looking for God, although we didn't know it, that's what we've been looking for. And the good news is, he comes to us. We've been looking to be in touch with the Creator. We've been looking to be in touch with the one who wrote the manual. We've been looking to be in touch with the one who knows how all this works. His name is Jesus. God's been working on the other end. That's why he sent Jesus more than 2,000 years ago, and that's why he still comes to us today. Scripture says Christ, God's Son, has come to us to help us understand and find the true God. That's what Christmas is all about. Jesus came to seek and to save. He came to help us. And while we've been seeking, he's been seeking us. The miracle of Christmas isn't on 34th Street, I hate to tell you. The miracle of Christmas is in Bethlehem. That's where it is. And he says, I offer you forgiveness from your past. I offer you peace of mind in the present. And I offer you a solid future for your eternity. Wow, those are good gifts. How do you receive those gifts? They're all wrapped up in Christ. You will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. Oh, that's the other thing I wanted to say. This is like the footnote. You get a changed heart. You can find a changed heart. I think almost all of us need a changed heart. Sometimes we want a Savior, but it's pretty selfish. Sometimes we want a Savior, but we don't want to change much. And so that's why I wanted to share this last story with you. I'm going to read it. I found it. I cried. I read it, I cried. There's a picture coming up on the screen. I want you to just fix this picture in your mind. It's just an old house that some poor folks live in. It could be anybody. You got it? You got it? You can remember that. Okay. It was Christmas Eve, 1942. I was 15 years old and feeling like the world had caved in on me because there just hadn't been enough money to buy me the rifle that I'd wanted for Christmas. We did the chores early that night for some reason. I just figured Dad wanted a little extra time so we could read the Bible. After supper was over, I took my boots off and stretched out in front of the fireplace and waited for Daddy to get down the old Bible. I was still feeling sorry for myself, and to be honest, I wasn't in much of a mood to read the scriptures. But Daddy didn't get the Bible. Instead, he bundled up again and went outside. I couldn't figure it out because we had already done all the chores. I didn't worry about it long, though, because I was too busy wallowing in my self-pity. Ever been there? Soon he came back in. It was a cold, clear night, and there was ice in his beard. "Come on, Matt," he said. "Bundle up. It's cold out tonight." I was really upset then. Not only wasn't I getting the rifle for Christmas, now he was dragging me out in the cold, and for no earthly reason that I could see. We'd already done the chores, and I couldn't think of anything else that needed doing, especially not on a night like this. But I knew he was not very patient at one dragging his feet when he told them to do something. So I got up, put on my boots, my coat. Mom gave me a curious smile as I opened the door to leave. Something was up, but I didn't know what. Outside, I became even more dismayed. There in front of the house was the work team already hitched to the big sled. Whatever it was we were going to do wasn't to be short or quick or a little job. I could tell we never hitched up this sled unless we were going to haul a big load. Daddy was already up on the seat, reins in hand. I reluctantly climbed up beside him. The cold was already biting at me. I wasn't happy. When I was on, Daddy pulled the sled around the house and stopped in front of the woodshed. He got off and I followed. "I think we'll put on the high sideboards," he said. "Here, help me." The high sideboards? It had been a bigger job than I wanted to do, just the low sideboards. But whatever it was, we were going to be a lot bigger, and it was going to be a bigger job with the high sideboards. Then Daddy went into the woodshed and came out with an armload of wood. The wood I'd spent all summer hauling down from the mountain and then all fall sawing into blocks and splitting. What was he doing? Finally, I said something. I asked, "What are you doing?" "You been by the Widow Jensen's lately?" he asked. Mrs. Jensen lived about 2 miles down the road. Her husband had died a year or so before and left her with 3 children, the oldest being 8. "Sure, I'd been by, but so what?" "Yeah," I said. "Why?" "I rode by just today," he said. "Little Jakey was out digging around in the wood pile trying to find a few chips. They're out of wood, Matt." That was all he said, and then he turned and went back into the woodshed for another armload of wood. I followed him. We loaded the sled so high that I began to wonder if the horses would be able to pull it. Finally, he called a halt to our loading, and then he went into the smokehouse, and he took down a big ham and a side of bacon. Of course, no one today even knows what a smokehouse is, let alone how to smoke it or how to cure it. We had a smokehouse on the farm. He handed ham and the bacon to me and told me to put them in the sled and wait. When he returned, he was carrying a sack of our flour over his right shoulder and a smaller sack of something in his left hand. "What's in the little sack?" I asked. "Shoes. They're out of shoes." Little Jakey just had gunny sacks wrapped around his feet when he was out in the woodpile this morning. I got the children a little candy, too. It just wouldn't be Christmas without a little candy. We rode the 2 miles to Mrs. Jensen's pretty much in silence. I tried to think through what Daddy was doing. We didn't have much by worldly standards. Of course, we did have a big wood pile, though most of what was left now was still in the form of logs that I would have to saw into blocks and split before we could use it. We also had meat and flour, so we could spare that, but I knew we didn't have any money, so why was he buying them shoes and candy? Really, why was he doing any of this? Widow Jensen had closer neighbors than us. It shouldn't have been our concern. We came in from the blind side of the Jensen house and unloaded the wood as quietly as possible. Then we took the meat and the flour and shoes to the door. We knocked. The door opened a crack and a timid voice said, "Who is it?" "Lucas Miles, ma'am, and my son, Matt. Could we come in for a bit?" Mrs. Jensen opened the door and let us in. She had a blanket wrapped around her shoulders. The children were wrapped in another and were sitting in front of the fireplace by a small fire that hardly gave off any heat at all. Mrs. Jensen fumbled with a match and finally lit the lamp. "We brought you a few things, ma'am," Daddy said, and set down the sack of flour. I put the meat on the table. Then he handed her the sack that had the shoes in it. She opened it hesitantly and took the shoes out one pair at a time. There was a pair for her and one for each of her children. Sturdy shoes, the best, shoes that would last. I watched her carefully. She bit her lower lip to keep it from trembling, and then tears filled her eyes and started running down her cheeks. She looked up at my daddy like she wanted to say something, but it wouldn't come out. "We brought a load of wood too, ma'am," he said. Then turned to me and said, "Matt, go bring in enough to last a while. Let's get that fire up to size and heat this place up." I wasn't the same person when I went back out to bring in the wood. I had a big lump in my throat, and as much as I hate to admit it, there were tears in my eyes too. In my mind, I kept seeing those three kids huddled around the fireplace and their mother standing there with tears running down her cheeks with so much gratitude in her heart that she couldn't speak. Oh, remember what I said, the fourth thing, a new heart. Remember? My heart swelled within me, and a joy that I'd never known before filled my soul. I had given at Christmas many times before, but never when it had made so much difference. I could see we were literally saving the lives of these people. I soon had the fire blazing, and everyone's spirits soared. The kids started giggling when Daddy handed them each a piece of candy, and Mrs. Jensen looked on with a smile that probably hadn't crossed her face for a long time. She finally turned to us. "God bless you," she said. "I know the Lord has sent you. The children and I have been praying that he would send one of his angels to spare us." In spite of myself, the lump returned to my throat and tears welled up in my eyes again. I'd never thought of my daddy in those exact terms before, but after Widow Jensen mentioned it, I could see that it was probably true. I was sure that a better man than Daddy had never walked the earth, I started remembering all the times he had gone out of his way for mommy and me and many others. The list seemed endless as I thought on. Daddy insisted that everyone try on the shoes before we left. I was amazed when they all fit, and I wondered how he had known what sizes to get. Then I guessed that if he was on an errand for the Lord, that the Lord would make sure he got the right sizes. Tears were running down Widow Jensen's face again when we stood up to leave. My daddy took each of the kids in his big arms and gave them a hug. They clung to him and didn't want us to go. I could see that they missed their daddy, and I was glad that I still had mine. At the door, he turned to Widow Jensen and said, "The missus wanted me to invite you and children over for Christmas dinner tomorrow. The turkey will be more than the three of us can eat, and a man can get cantankerous if he has to eat turkey for too many meals. We'll be by to get you about 11. It'll be nice to have some little ones around again. Matt here hasn't been little for quite a spell. I was the youngest. My two brothers and two sisters had all married and had moved away." Mrs. Jensen nodded and said, "Thank you, Brother Miles. I don't have to say, may the Lord bless you." I know for certain that he will. Out on the sled, I felt a warmth that came from deep within, and I didn't even notice the cold. When we had gone a ways, Daddy turned to me and said, "Matt, I want you to know something. Your mother and me have been tucking away a little money here and there all year so we could buy that rifle for you, but we didn't have quite enough. Then yesterday, a man who owed me a little money from years back came by to make things square. Your mom and me were real excited, thinking that now we could get you that rifle. And I started into town this morning to do just that. But on the way, I saw little Jakey out scratching in the woodpile with his feet wrapped in those gunny sacks, and I knew what I had to do. Son, I spent the money for shoes and for a little candy for those children. I hope you understand." I understood, and my eyes became wet with tears again. I understood very well, and I was so glad Daddy had done it. Now the rifle seemed very low on my list of priorities. He had given me a lot more. He had given me the look on Mrs. Jensen's face and the radiant smiles of her three children. For the rest of my life, whenever I saw any of the Jensens or split a block of wood, I remembered, and remembering brought back the same joy I felt riding home beside my daddy that night. He had given me much, much more than a rifle that night. He had given me the best Christmas of my life. And my question, yeah. What will you give this Christmas? It isn't the material things that matter. God gave us his very best. He sacrificed so that we could have forgiveness, peace of mind, eternal life. But that last one, a changed heart. When we have God, he changes our heart. That father gave a great gift. And his son's heart was changed because the father acted like the heavenly father and gave good gifts that would change and transform lives. I pray that this Christmas, God will change our hearts and we will realize it's not the stuff in the boxes. It's the stuff of life where we care and give and help and lift up those around us. We're going to worship with just a simple chorus. We were singing it really joyfully a little while ago, and now we're going to sing it worshipfully. If I can get anybody back to help me, there we go. Oh, come, let us adore him. And let's stand and give thanks this morning, because he alone is worthy of all of our praise.
Come, let us
come on, sing
adore
it out.
Him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. We'll give him all the glory. We'll give him all the glory. We'll give him all the glory.
Now we pray that through all of those gifts that you give us, our hearts would be changed so that it wouldn't be just about us. It would be about honoring you and living out the heart of God. I love the words that describe David, a man after God's own heart. Doesn't mean he was like God. It meant he was seeking to be like him, pursuing the heart of God. And may Christmas be the time when we renew our commitment to pursuing the heart of God so that we have changed hearts. Lord, bless your people. May the joy and the peace of Christmas fill their lives. And may it overflow to those around them. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Merry Christmas. Don't forget, Tuesday night, 5 and 7, we're going to be here and we're going to worship and have a great time. God bless you. Give someone a hug.
of earth, born to give them second birth.